Einstein's Relativity, The Special Theory and the General Theory. Chapter 3. New Modern Translation 2024. Albert Einstein and Harry Yoon, Translator. Introduction, Chapter 3. This is the third book of this single chapter edition series, based on the book Einstein's Relativity, The Special Theory and the General Theory, New Modern Translation 2024-2025. This short booklet includes Chapter 3 and only Chapter 3 from the book. This book was originally written in German by Albert Einstein, his native language, and it was first published in 1917 in Germany. It was one of the few scientific writings by Einstein that were intended for the general audience. It is not, however, one of those popular science books. This book covers real physics, both the special theory and the general theory of relativity. In fact, it is a rather unique book in many respects, as it was written by the very person who created the theory. It explains relativity at the deepest and most fundamental level, without going into too much details. This book is divided into roughly two equal halves, and the first half is dedicated to special relativity, and the other half, comprising parts 2 and 3, are about general relativity. We will mainly focus on special relativity for now, and we will come back to general relativity in the second half of the book. Although anybody can learn special relativity, with some determination, different people may have to put in a different amount of time and effort to get the essential story of the theory. For some people, it may take days or weeks. For some other people, it may take months or years. Regardless, don't be discouraged. Just think about how lucky you are. You are one of the tiny fraction of the 8 billion people who ever thought about learning relativity and who actually took an action. In the scheme of things, how much you end up learning is not that important, unless, of course, you want to become a career physicist specializing in foundational physics. Special relativity is a fascinating theory which predicts and explains many seemingly strange and counterintuitive phenomena in nature, although most of them lie outside our everyday experience. If you are a casual reader who is interested in those aspects of special relativity, then quickly going through this Einstein's book will give you some big picture view. On the other hand, if you are interested in truly understanding special relativity at a deeper level, but without getting into too much details or too much math, then this Einstein's book is also the best guide for you, regardless of why you have decided to learn relativity in the first place. As with any kind of knowledge, once you learn and understand special relativity, it becomes trivial and almost obvious. How you get there is, however, a different matter. This book is rather different from many modern textbooks on relativity. For one thing, the emphasis of the book is different from those of most of the more modern books. Einstein himself sought a deeper understanding of nature throughout his life, and he focuses on the fundamentals of relativity rather than minute details, even in this book aimed for the popular audience who are not necessarily physicists. In the first chapter of the book, Einstein's Relativity, Einstein emphasizes the importance of the empirical nature of physics. Even when we use mathematics as a tool, its correspondence with the physical world is critical. For example, in the following chapter, he defines the physical distance between two points relative to a particular reference frame, or using a concrete rigid body of reference, by connecting the two points with a straight line and by laying down a standard measuring stick. Although this particular physical measurement may not always be carried out in practice exactly as prescribed, having this real-world interpretation is essential in physics. In the second chapter of the book, Einstein further emphasizes the importance of using reference frames and coordinate systems, for instance, when we specify the location position of an event or object. He continues his argument along this line in this chapter, now with respect to motion and time, in addition to position in space, but still within the context of classical mechanics. Chapter 3. Space and time in classical mechanics. If I just formulated mechanics without any careful thoughts or clarification, merely as a task of describing, how bodies change their position in space with time. Then I would be committing some serious sins in my conscience against the sacred spirit of clarity and precision. Let us quickly see what exactly these sins would be. First of all, it is not clear what is meant by position and space in this formulation. Suppose that I stand by the window of a railroad car, of a train, which is traveling uniformly at a steady pace, on a straight track on the perfectly level ground. I now gently drop a stone on the embankment outside the window, that is, without throwing it with an initial velocity. Then, ignoring the effect of air resistance, I see the stone moving or falling down in a straight line in space. But on the other hand, a pedestrian, who happens to observe this mischievous deed from the ground, notices that the stone falls from the moving train to the embankment in a parabolic curve in space. I now ask, so in reality, is it a straight line or a parabola that the positions of the falling stone make in space? Moreover, what do we exactly mean by the motion in space in these descriptions? The answer should be rather obvious from the considerations of the previous chapter, Chapter 2. First of all, we should stop using the vague expression motion in space and the equally ill-defined word space, to which we should admit in all honesty we cannot attach any physically significant meanings in the slightest. Instead, we propose that we should use descriptions like motion in relation to a practically rigid body, or a body of reference in its place. A more precise way of specifying the physical locations in relation to a reference body, e.g., a railroad car or embankment, or its generalization, a reference frame, has already been described in some detail in the previous chapter. With body of reference replaced by a more abstract concept, frame of reference, or system of coordinates, which is useful for mathematical treatment, as will be further explained in the later chapters, we can now make the following two separate and more or less independent statements, without any vagueness or ambiguity and without any contradiction. Relative to a frame of reference, or system of coordinates, which is rigidly attached to the moving train, the falling stone traverses a straight line path. Relative to another frame of reference, or system of coordinates, rigidly attached to the ground, on the other hand, the same falling stone makes a parabolic curve. This simple example clearly shows that there is no such thing as an independently existing trajectory in reality, e.g., a trajectory of motion in space, but only a trajectory with reference to a particular body of reference or a frame of reference. Furthermore, we should also note that a full and complete description of the motion of a body can only be constructed by indicating how the body changes its position over the course of time. That is, for each point along the trajectory of a body with respect to the same frame of reference, it must also be specified at what time the body is located at that particular point. Hence, the description of motion in mechanics can only be complete when we have a proper definition of time, so that these time values can be viewed as physically observable quantities, e.g., the results of measurement, by virtue of this definition. In the case of our moving train and falling stone example, if we were to stick to the paradigm of classical mechanics for now, then we could satisfy this requirement in the following manner. We imagine having two clocks that are identical in every way. One is held by a man on the moving train by the window, and the other by another man on the embankment. Each of the two men observes the motion of the falling stone over time and records its position with respect to his own frame of reference every time his clock is ticking at that exact moment. In doing so, we have ignored the imprecision of the time measurement, which is the result of the finite speed of light. This, and also another difficulty which becomes apparent in this context, will be discussed in detail in the next and subsequent chapters. Translator's notes. We all learned in the high school physics class that mechanics is a study of motion, and the motion of a body is the changing position of the body in space in the course of time. What's wrong with that? Space and time are such mundane concepts. We are all familiar with them, and we all think that we know what they are at the most intuitive level, as they are deeply ingrained in our habit of thought. We live somewhere in space, and we live through the flow of time after all. However, Einstein started this book by questioning our very notions of position and distance in space, in the first two chapters. He continues with this question in this chapter by further challenging all the fundamental concepts of classical mechanics, now including time and motion, and the space itself. A quick summary. In classical mechanics, describing the motion of a body is viewed as specifying how the body changes its position in space over time. This traditional formulation has a number of problems. First, the concepts of position and space are not well defined. For example, if we drop a stone from a moving train, it will look as if it is falling in a straight line when it is observed by us. On the other hand, the same motion may look like a parabolic curve to an observer standing on the ground. Hence, the descriptions like motion in space have no real physical significance. A motion can only be described with respect to a specific frame of reference. Second, describing the motion of a body involves specifying the time associated with each position of the body along the trajectory. Hence, the description of motion can only be complete when we have a proper definition of time, such that these time values can be viewed as physically measurable quantities using this definition. To keep track of the positions as well as the times of a moving body along its trajectory of motion, we need an observer with a clock in each reference frame. All observers will need to use identical clocks. Each observer then observes the motion of the body and records its position and time with respect to his own reference frame every time his clock is ticking. Newton's absolute space. Einstein, in the first few chapters of this book, gradually and methodically deconstructs some of the most fundamental concepts in Galileo-Newtonian, or classical or pre-relativistic mechanics. The first target is Newton's idea of absolute space, or even just space. In the previous chapter, he asserted that the position of an object, or of an event, could not be specified just in space. We would need a rigid body of reference, or its more abstract sibling, frame of reference with an associated Cartesian coordinate system, to be able to meaningfully specify positions in the real world. With regards to describing motions in mechanics, essentially the same argument applies since the motion of a body in time is a continuous series of the positions of the given body in the course of the continuous passage of time. In this chapter, Einstein makes use of another thought experiment, his trademark, in which he poses a question as to how to describe a motion of a falling stone from a moving train, to support his argument that motion in space is not a physically meaningful concept. As stated, describing a motion over time is a simple generalization of the argument given in the previous chapter with respect to specifying a position at a given time. But the current argument is even more persuasive, at a more intuitive level. In the particular example used by Einstein, there is no single objective motion or trajectory in space which can be agreed on by all observers. Hence, such a thing does not exist, at least if we assume that physics deals with some kind of objective reality. Frame of reference in classical mechanics. In the first three chapters of the book so far, Einstein claimed that any physical quantities like distance could only be meaningfully defined in relation to a physical rigid body, from which the concepts of coordinate systems and reference frames arose. He also demonstrated that a position of a physical body, or that of a point mass, should be specified with respect to a second rigid body for reference, and not just in space. The concept of the reference frame, which allows the use of the Cartesian coordinates, x, y, z, is essentially an extension of the role of this second physical body. Now we can completely do away with the vague concept of space as long as we only deal with classical mechanics, e.g., Newton's equations of motion, and special relativity. We can define all fundamental mechanical quantities like positions, distances, and time-dependent motions with respect to a particular frame of reference. Space is therefore no longer necessary in formulating mechanics, as we will further see in the next chapter and throughout the first half of the book, which only deals with special relativity. Time is also another such physical quantity that can be most meaningfully defined and used with respect to a reference frame. Newton's absolute time. The concept of space had puzzled philosophers since the beginning of Western philosophy, some 2,500 years ago. There were many different and competing theories on space. Newton largely adopted the idea of Aristotle. He, being a deeply religious person, believed that space corresponded to the presence of God. Space was eternal and infinite, and it was everywhere just like God. More or less the same can be said about Newton's idea of absolute time. But when it comes to time, the situation is a little bit more complicated. First of all, time is a much more elusive concept than space. Since the ancient times, philosophers and physicists had been likewise puzzled by the idea of time, and they had come up with various theories to explain time. Plato, for example, considered motion or change as time. For instance, the sun rises and sets and it rises again. Then it's a day. Newton could not, however, use such an imprecise definition of time as the foundation for his mathematical formulation of physics. Newton's true innovation was that he treated time as something that existed independently or even outside of our universe, and therefore he elevated time to something abstract. Time existed even without anything moving in the universe. Time is the same everywhere in the world. It was as if there was an invisible hand that controlled all the clocks in the world, all perfectly synchronized. The movement of the world could now be described with respect to this global and universal time, and not the other way around. Now, Einstein was an empiricist. If you haven't noticed, one common theme throughout the first three chapters of this book so far is that all physically meaningful quantities should have proper definitions, in view of which we should be able to physically measure their values, that is, at least in principle. Time is no exception. Einstein proposes in this chapter the following method of measuring time, still in the context of classical mechanics. We imagine having two clocks that are identical in every way. One is held by a man on the moving train by the window, and the other by another man on the embankment. Each of the two men observes the motion of the falling stone over time and records its position, with respect to his own frame of reference, every time his clock is ticking at that exact moment. Here, according to the notion of Newton's absolute time, it is assumed that the two clocks indicate the same time, and they progress at exactly the same rate. The only difference between these two clocks is that they are located possibly at two different locations. But more importantly, in this Einstein's formulation, these two clocks are associated with two different reference frames, which may be in a relative motion with respect to each other. Another difference from Newton's absolute time is that there is no global universal time. The time associated with a particular position of a moving body is measured by a clock at, or near, that particular position. Speed versus velocity. In mechanics, to represent how fast a body moves, or in other words, to indicate the rate of a motion, we use the concept of speed or velocity. These two common English words, speed and velocity, have two slightly different meanings in physics. Velocity is a vector, that is, a quantity with a magnitude and a direction. On the other hand, speed is a scalar, that is, only with a magnitude. In fact, the magnitude of the velocity of a moving body is the speed of that body. We mostly deal with one-dimensional examples in this book, and hence we generally use the two terms interchangeably, unless it is necessary to make a clear distinction. Just keep in mind, however, that a motion has a direction, even in one dimension. What's next? Now, the deconstruction of the fundamental concepts of classical mechanics is complete. This is a lot to take in, especially if you are completely new to physics. But as stated, we will rely on these improved and more precisely formulated concepts when we start learning relativity. The next chapter is about inertial reference frame, which is another essential and fundamental concept in classical mechanics, as well as in special relativity. The next chapter, Chapter 4, the inertial frame of reference.